Live from CBS 4, your news at 11 starts right now.
To the individual that committed this crime, you are not as good as you think you are. You left behind evidence. We will find you.
Closing in on a killer, the promise tonight from police to catch the man who killed a pastor's pregnant wife.
But we start tonight with news breaking out of Paris, where a series of coordinated terrorist attacks has left more than 150 people dead. Good evening, everyone. Thanks for joining us. I'm Bob Donaldson.
I'm Debbie Knox. It's being called the worst attack on France since World War II. Here's the very latest now. Tonight, a state of emergency has been declared. And in an unprecedented move, the country's borders have been closed. At least 153 people were killed. Paris police now say all of the attackers are dead. Their identities and motives are not known.
The worst attack happened at a concert hall where a rock band from California was playing. More than 100 people were killed. Three attackers reportedly blew themselves up after police arrived. Gunmen also killed 11 people at a restaurant.
Two explosions also rocked North Paris near the soccer stadium where France was playing Germany. Fans evacuated the stands. The French president was also there and taken to safety. Tonight, President Obama pledged his support to France.
It's an attack not just on the people of France, but this is an attack on all of humanity.
U.S. Department of Homeland Security says there's no credible threat against the U.S. Indiana's Department of Homeland Security is echoing that sentiment. It released a statement within the hour asking Hoosiers to be vigilant. And if you see something suspicious, report it by calling 1-877-226-1026. Or if danger is imminent, call 911.
Two students with ties to Central Indiana are in Paris tonight, not far from where those terrorists hit. I talked with both of them tonight via Skype. They shared their sense of shock and fear.
I immediately called my mom and dad.
Devin Selmer immediately thought of her family back here in Indiana when news broke of the terrorist attacks in Paris. The Avon native studies at the Academy for International Management in Paris, not far from where the attacks happened.
It rocks me to my core. It's terrifying to just imagine that this could have been me and it could have been my situation, and I had no idea.
You're just going to the concert and then you're not safe anymore.
Lucille Aymonier studied recently at Ball State as an exchange student. She lives back in Paris now and goes to the restaurants and bars that were struck.
This could happen everywhere, and you think it's only to some places, but actually it's not. It's just in your neighborhood.
Both Indiana students say Paris will be a much different city tomorrow, one that will feel much less safe.
The present is important. Knowing that people I love are safe.
We check with other universities across the state to see if they have any students studying abroad. IU says it has 16 students in France right now. All of them have been accounted for and are safe. Purdue and Butler say they have no students in Paris this semester.
Well, the owner of a French restaurant on Mass Ave is in shock over the terrorist attacks in his home city. Stephane Coueff has a 25-year-old son who lives in Paris. Adrian Coueff is a medical school student. He contacted his father to assure him that he was safe, but he has other relatives in Paris as well. How is your family doing? Is everybody okay?
Yes, everybody is okay. I have a contact from them, and fortunately, they all are okay now.
Coueff owns a Croquechon et Bidiboule with his wife. They named that restaurant after their two sons.
Tonight's attacks come just one day after the apparent killing of the masked Islamic terrorists known as Jihadi John in a U.S. drone strike. U.S. officials believe they finally got the ISIS leader responsible for the beheadings of several hostages, including North Central High School graduate Abdul Rahman Kasik. His family here in Indianapolis is not commenting on that news.
Well, new at 11 o'clock, the westbound lanes of Interstate 70 in Henry County are closed at this hour after a fiery crash. This is around the 127th mile marker. Police say a semi carrying coal crashed and caught fire. Several other vehicles were involved and six people were flown to the hospital. The highway could be closed for hours and they're being told to avoid the area. We'll update you on the air and at CBS4Indy.com as soon as we learn more.
Now to the latest on a crime that has central Indiana on edge. Tonight, police say they're closing in on the gunman who murdered a pregnant pastor's wife during a home invasion.
CBS 4's Lindsay Eaton is live at IMPD's Northwest Side with the latest on this investigation. Lindsay.
Yes, investigators coming out earlier today saying they have a surveillance picture of the man they believe killed Amanda Blackburn. While they may not know this person's name, they're making it known they're onto him.
We'll never be able to repair the damage that's been done to the Blackburn family.
It's another night Amanda Blackburn's family is without her, and it's another night her killer is on the loose.
For those responsible for killing Amanda, we are coming.
Shortly after 6 Tuesday morning, investigators believe someone was watching the Blackburns' home when Amanda's husband, Davey, left to go to the gym.
We believe that when Mr. Blackburn left to go work out, they saw an opportunity to burglarize another home.
They got inside and shot Amanda in the head. Davey found her about 2 hours later.
We're angry. We're upset. We're frustrated. So is the community.
We checked safetown.org. It's the city's online crime tracking tool. On Tuesday morning from 5 until noon, there were 11 other home burglaries reported within 20 miles from the Blackburns' home. So far, the only crime IMPD would confirm is connected is the one that happened a couple doors down from the Blackburn home. A neighbor told police they saw someone in a dark-colored hoodie leaving the scene.
To the individual that committed this crime, you are not as good as you think you are. You left behind evidence. We will find it. We have found it. We will find you.
IMPD sources tell us a stolen vehicle was recovered this week. Investigators believe it could have something to do with Amanda's murder. Another clue bringing detectives closer to her killer.
And we will not stop until we get you.
Now, police have yet to release that surveillance picture of the suspect. They're expected to do so next week. We're live tonight on the city's Northwest Side. Lindsay Eaton, CBS 4 News.
Lindsay, thank you. You know, thousands of messages of support have poured in on social media for the Blackburn family. On their church's Facebook page, condolences are coming in from as far away as Australia and Africa. A prayer service to celebrate the life of Amanda Blackburn will be held Sunday at 5 o'clock at Traders Point Christian Church. The public is welcome to attend.
IMPD will get help from the Marion County Sheriff's Department to combat the rise in violent crime. Sheriff John Layton says Chief Rick Height asked for the reinforcement a few weeks ago. 15 reserve deputies will join Metro officers on the streets of Indianapolis. They'll also work together with state police on sharing intelligence information.
It's not that we're trying to encroach on anyone else. We waited for the invitation, and it has come. It has come, and we're more than happy to help out.
The Sheriff's Department's main duties are to operate the jail, serve search warrants, and track down fugitives. But they do have the same power as IMPD to pull over cars. In fact, deputies made about 13,000 arrests last year.
Well, new court filings reveal Jared Fogle is asking for the minimum sentence as part of his guilty plea on child sex and pornography charges. Defense attorneys for the former Subway pitchman is asking Fogle receive 5 years in prison. Prosecutors are asking, though, for 12 and a half years. The court documents also reveal Fogle is seeking treatment for sex and alcohol addictions. Fogle will be sentenced next Thursday and will take the stand during those proceedings.
Tomorrow night, all eyes will be on Iowa when the Democratic candidates for president debate in prime time right here on CBS 4. Matt Smith has made his way to Des Moines, Iowa tonight.
He joins us live at Drake University where the debate will be held. Hey, Matt.
Yeah, hi guys. Good evening from a chilly Des Moines, Iowa, where we made the trip this afternoon. The stage is set, as you can see behind me. The first in the nation Iowa caucuses begin in just 2.5 months. This is all just in time for tomorrow night for Hillary Clinton, Bernie Sanders, and Martin O'Malley to take the stage here at Drake University in front of a national audience. Let's take a look. This is what they are going up against in the new CBS News New York Times poll. Hillary Clinton maintaining that sizable lead among primary voters. 52% nationwide in that new poll out yesterday. Bernie Sanders coming in at 33%, O'Malley with 5%. Here's a look inside the debate hall. The final preparations underway at this hour. About 700 invited guests will be inside this auditorium tomorrow night, many of them Democratic Party activists and donors. Given these poll numbers you just saw, the stakes are still high for this second Democratic debate. Analysts here in Iowa are predicting both Sanders and O'Malley will go after Clinton more. And don't forget, these candidates do disagree on a number of key issues, including gun control, foreign policy, and health care. As for Indiana, that state has not voted for a Democratic president. They've only voted once for a Democratic president since 1968. That was Barack Obama in 2008, and he only won by less than 1% of the vote. So it is those voters, the group of undecided voters across the country tomorrow night, that these candidates still are going to try to target and persuade and convince before we go into this holiday lull and then the Democratic caucuses and the caucuses here on February 1st. The debate begins at 9 o'clock right here on CBS 4 tomorrow night. We will be inside. We'll be back out here tomorrow at 11 to bring you a recap and analysis of everything we just heard. For now, live from Des Moines, Iowa, Matt Smith, CBS 4 News.
Matt, thank you very much. Well, a scam warning tonight from the FBI. Hackers shut down your computer and then demand that you pay ransom to get control back. It's not just personal computers being targeted. Businesses, schools, even police departments have been hit with the uncrackable code.
Basically said, pay this ransom before this countdown runs out or you're going to lose all your files forever.
Received a pop-up ransom note like this one. She refused to pay the $800. Instead, she had her computer wiped clean and started over.
You can't get past the screen once it comes
up. You're stuck. This is it. You can't get any further until you follow the hacker's instructions to pay them the ransom.
The Cyber Threat Alliance says that more than $325 million in computer ransom demands has been paid out globally. Experts say it's important to update antivirus software and back up all your data.
A cold evening across central Indiana tonight. We could drop into the 20s overnight. But a weekend warm-up is on tap. Here's the Weather Authority Chief Meteorologist Chris Wright. Hi, Chris.
Yeah, Bob, I think that warm-up is going to be very welcome across central Indiana coming up this weekend. No rainfall right now on Live Guardian radar, so just clear skies across central Indiana. But there is a chill in the air. We're already down to 33 degrees here in the state capitol. High temperature made it up to 50 today after a low temperature in the 30s. And tonight we're going down into the 20s, down to 29 here in the state capitol, but colder in Peru, forecasting a low of 22 and 28 for the low temperature in Bloomington. Big football games going on tomorrow. Marion University taking on Siena Heights at 1 o'clock. We'll find sunny skies and temperatures in the 50s tomorrow, but you notice the winds only from the southwest at 10 miles per hour, so not the stiff breeze we had today. IU taking on Michigan at 3:30. We'll have clear skies down in Bloomington tomorrow, but here comes some rainfall moving in next week. A chance of rain coming up on Monday, then strong thunderstorms are likely with some heavy downpours on Tuesday and also on Wednesday. In the forecast overnight, down to 29 degrees and expect sunshine for your Saturday, but a cool day with a high temperature at 53. And the 7-day forecast from the Weather Authority will find it about 10 degrees warmer on Sunday with a high at 62. Then a daily chance of rain is going to come our way on Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday. Back to dry weather, but cooler for us coming up on Thursday and on Friday.
All right, thank you very much, Chris. That's it for CBS 4 News at 11 o'clock.
Coming up, football Friday night. Tonight, we're at two semi-state showdowns. Find out who's going to the state title game. That's next.
From Indy Sports Central, this is Football Friday Night.
Welcome into Football Friday Night. I'm Tricia Whitaker. The quest for a state championship continues tonight around the state. We've got highlights from eight teams this evening. And we begin with the top dogs in 6A, the number one in-state and unbeaten Center Grove Trojans facing the number six Avon Orioles. The Trojans and Orioles playing for a spot in the 6A championship tonight. 3-3 in the second quarter, and the Trojans are on the move. Joey Seiderwitz up top to Jackson DeHolt into the end zone. Center Grove up 10-3. Orioles ball now, and Michigan signee, check this out, Brandon Peters, deep to Andrew Griffin. He's going to Princeton. 20-yard touchdown, tied 10-10 at halftime. And we head to the second half. Avon taking the lead on this Bryant Fitzgerald diving effort. Puts the Orioles up 17-10, but the Trojans, well, they just wouldn't quit. Titus McCoy, the running back, takes it in for the 2-yard score. It's 17 all. The Orioles have less than 3 minutes to go. Game on the line. Peters connects with Harrison Weber. Huge gain into the end zone, into the red zone, excuse me. But they settle for a field goal from Tyler Shanahan. That makes it 20-17 with two and change to go. Center Grove driving down the field now. 4 seconds to go. Nathaniel Snyder makes it 20 all. The game would go into overtime, but Center Grove comes out on top 35-34 in double overtime. And Carmel visiting Penn tonight. The Kingsmen, strong defense, up 13-3 in the fourth. 40-yard field goal attempt, and it's good. 16-6 advantage now. The Greyhounds on the drive. Jake McDonald, check this out. He hits Ethan Merriweather, a perfect pass and a great catch. That makes it 16-10. An onside kick is coming. Some near side trickery. Goes far side, but the ball is out of bounds, and Penn defeats Carmel 16-10. And now we head to Class 5A, where we start with New Pal taking on Zionsville. The Dragons moved up to 5A this year after they won it all in Class 4A last season. New Pal undefeated on the year, facing the 5-6 Zionsville Eagles. New Palestine starts the game strong on their opening drive. Alex Zeli finds Duke Blackwell, who races past two defenders into the end zone for the game's first score. Zionsville started slow, but they found some offense later in the first quarter. Brendan Mikesell breaks past a host of defenders for the touchdown. New Pal leads 14-7. More offense from the Dragons in the second quarter. Neely lofts it to Blackwell. He breaks three tackles to score the touchdown. New Pal wins it 49-21. The Dragons move on to semi-state, and they will face the winner here. 11-0, Bloomington South taking on Castle tonight. The Panthers, well, they dig a hole for themselves, but they claw back. Christian Pekak takes it in from a yard out. Bloomington South down just a score, 23-13. And a little later on, Gavin Yeske finds John Earl Rochelle Manns for the touchdown. That cuts it to 21-19. And check this out, the Panthers, they're going for two, but they're stopped. It's 21-19, Castle at the half, and the Knights go on to win it, 45-25. Panthers undefeated season comes to an end. More 5A regionals. Kokomo is 11-0. The Wildcats hosted Westfield this evening. Kokomo knocking on the door. Kyle Wade, quarterback sneak for the first score of the game, 7-0. Westfield Stern, quarterback run by Andrew Sweet, ties the game up at 7. And Westfield receiving the punt now. But Kobe Hauser, he muffs it. Recovered by 21, Brevin Beard of Kokomo. And the muff punt, you guessed it, leads to a touchdown run. Running back Marcel Kenner into the end zone. And Kokomo pulls out the 21-19 win. The Wildcats move on to semi-state, where they will face Fort Wayne Snyder, coming off a 42-32 win over Mishawaka. Kokomo has never been in the state title. One more win, and they finally get there. There you see the scoreboard I was just talking about right there. Well, down to 4A, more regional action. Ron Colley and Delta for a spot in semi-state. Delta's Zach Mills, check this out. He fumbles it, but it's recovered by Nate Evil. Ron Colley would fumble the next play later in the first. We're at fourth and goal. In just a second, we'll be at fourth and goal after they're done celebrating. Robbie Strader finds Nate Fries. 7-0 now. Next Ron Colley possession. Strader again to Will Harris for the touchdown. Ron Colley wins it 49-12. Well, much more to come here on Football Friday night. Coming up, we wrap up high school football with three more games, and then we transition to some college hoop. Teams all around the country tipping off their season tonight. We'll take you to Bloomington, Purdue, Notre Dame, and IUPUI coming up next.
Indy Sports Central. This is Football Friday Night.
Welcome back to Football Friday Night. We head to 3A now, where Batesville and Chittard are facing each other. They're playing for a spot in next Friday's semi-state game. First quarter, Matthew Annie, check this out. He crushes Bulldogs quarterback Leo Enneking. Pete Sanders picks it up in the end zone for the easiest touchdown of his life and a 7-0 lead. Second quarter, it's Jared Stiver breaking free for a touchdown. Trojans on top, 14-0 after his trip into the end zone. Then, just before halftime, Lewis Diltz puts it up for Max McGinnis, who comes down with it. Chatard up 21-0. The Trojans pitch the shutout 33-0. And in Class 2A, the Howe Hornets looking for their first regional title ever up against Cecina. Howe's Justin Johnson makes a move. It gets in for the one-yard touchdown to put the Hornets up 13-7. Next Howe possession, Johnson scrambles and finds Dante Henderson for the score. And the Hornets go up 20-7. Cecina still fighting, though. Darius Mitchell takes the handoff and is stripped by Jaleen Jones. Howe recovers it. Under 3 minutes to go, Henderson takes a handoff and outruns everybody. 99 yards to the house to give Howe its first regional championship. Very exciting. Hornets get the win 26-7. All right, to the hardwood now. Tonight, Tom Crean and the 15th-ranked Hoosiers tipped off their season, putting the offseason problems looming over the team behind them. To Assembly Hall we go, where Indiana faces Eastern Illinois. First half, James Blackman Jr. nails the three. 17 points tonight, a team high for him. 49-17 at halftime. Second half, Yogi Ferrell, 13 points. But he misses this three. No worries, though. Troy Williams with the putback dunk. 51-17 now. And more of Indiana in the second half. Inside to freshman Thomas Bryant. Layup, and he gets the foul. 11 points, 9 boards for Bryant tonight. And Indiana runs away with the win, 88-49. Matt Painter and the 23rd-ranked Boilers tipping off their year against North Carolina A&T. No A.J. Hammonds tonight. First half, Ryan Klein from Carmel puts it in for three, 4-for-6 beyond the arc tonight with 13 points for him. And another freshman, Caleb Swanigan, he can shoot too. Check his three out. It's good. 11 points, 11 rebounds for Swanigan this evening. Second half, Boilers lead 65-30. Johnny Hill ahead to Rafael Davis. Layup and one. 14 points led the team. Purdue wins it 81-40. And to South Bend we go. Notre Dame facing St. Francis of Pennsylvania. Irish raising a banner for its first conference tournament title in school history. First half, the Red Flash with the lead, but not for long. Demetrius Jackson buries the three-pointer to put the Irish on top. Later on, Jackson, the beautiful give-and-go with Zach August. Jackson with the flush, and he's fouled. Jackson pours in a career-high 27 points. Notre Dame wins it 87-56. And IUPUI and Tara Hoach facing Indiana State to open up their season. The Jaguars work it around to Lehi Svet, who buries the three-pointer. Then a little later on, Marcellus Barksdale takes the rock and weaves his way to the hoop. You'll see it in just a second. IUPUI gets the win, 72-70. And Ball State opened their season on the road facing Bradley. They lost 54-53 to the Braves. The Cardinals now have lost 18 straight games. Well, after a shaky start to the season, the Pacers have won 5 out of the last 6 games. Tonight, they were back home after defeating the Celtics on Wednesday. Indiana facing the Minnesota Timberwolves at the Fieldhouse this evening. Second quarter, Monte Ellis kicks it out to Paul George. He buries the three-pointer. Ellis with 5 assists tonight. George, great first half. This three off the screen makes it 15 points in the first half for PG. Pacers lead 61-50 at halftime. Third quarter, Ellis grabs the steal. He takes it down, and he puts it in. Ellis with 24 points on the night. The Pacers led by 27 in the third quarter, but now in the fourth, their lead is just 3. Andrew Wiggins puts it in underneath for the basket, and the Pacers up by only 1 now. But Minnesota, lucky for the Pacers, they were unable to mount a full comeback. Indiana escapes with the victory, 107-103.
You know, we can't take teams lightly, giving up 30 points in the fourth. Unacceptable. But, you know, we were aware this team was going to keep coming, and that's what they did. You know, it's a young team, a lot of talent. They don't give up.
They're an explosive team that is full of young guys and never quit on games. You know, so we knew that a game was never going to be in hand. You know, no matter what the score was, we knew they're going to keep coming. And you know, obviously, when you have a big lead, the opposing coach is going to try to change the game.
All right, that's all we've got for you on Football Friday Night. Unfortunately, we're going to be dipping into the 20s overnight. Chief Meteorologist Chris Wright will have more on a weekend warm-up when we come back.
Get ready for a cold start to the weekend, down to a low temperature of 29 degrees, the coldest night we've had so far this month. We'll have sunshine during the day on Saturday, the high at 54, and the winds won't be as strong from the southwest at 5 to 10 miles per hour. We'll see warmer temperatures with sunshine on Sunday, the high at 62. Enjoy the dry weekend. We'll have a daily chance of rain coming up on Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday with highs in the 60s on Tuesday and Wednesday, then dry and cooler on Thursday and Friday. For Friday, your high only at 45 degrees.
All right, thanks so much, Chris. Enjoy the warm-up this weekend. I know I will because I hate that incoming cold weather we've got. Thanks so much for joining us on Football Friday Night. Have a wonderful evening.